Hi, my name is John Huvane. I worked for Rudolph Giuliani for about 18 years. I'm first generation Irish. My mom and dad are both from Ireland. Mom is from Galway and my dad is from Mayo also. And I've been involved in the Irish culture for years, playing Gaelic football with the Celtics minor football team, the Mayo seniors, and after that I joined the police department and ended up playing on the finest Gaelic football team.
You've quite a record. You were president of the NYPD GA team?
Yes, yeah, it was an honor. A great bunch of guys, great organization. Part of what our parents brought over from Ireland alive. And it was just great, great, high caliber guys playing against the fire department and different police departments, and capping it off by going back to Ireland and playing the Garda Síochána was the cap of my Gaelic football career.
Keep a heritage alive.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
So tell me, getting to business, what was your assignment on 9/11?
On 9/11, I was assigned to the executive protection detail for Mayor Giuliani. I was in the capacity of a advance person. What that would basically mean is any event that the mayor would attend, I would go ahead of time, set up the entrances, the exits, where to stage the cars, and just basically bang out the logistics of the event. And make it as smooth and safe as possible for the mayor to attend.
Where were you when the first terror fell?
I was just finishing up an advance at a hotel in Midtown Manhattan. The mayor, Mayor Giuliani, was meeting with Bill Simon and Dennison Young at a breakfast meeting. And I was working with my colleague, Patty Verone. And she ends up receiving a phone call, and she just leaned over to me and said that a plane had struck one of the towers at the Ground Zero or the World Trade Center. And at that point, I knew the mayor and had worked for him at that point 2 years prior to him being mayor, and then we're finishing up. It was election day here in New York City, and it was relatively going to be a quiet day. And we were winding down the administration, so knowing the mayor, I knew something, any major event he loves to go to, because he feels he can get a better gauge of what's actually happened than receiving phone calls. So I knew he'd be going, and at that point, I left the hotel and jumped in my car and started heading down to the World Trade Center.
You were with the mayor.
Mm-hmm.
What was it like in the middle of all that chaos?
It was amazing. I had a chance to reflect, of course, 10 years now, and thinking what had happened. But when it actually was happening, we would just move from step to step to step. The mayor was trying to gather as much information from the fire department, trying to gather as much information from the police department, and set up a temporary office of operations. We, at that point, went into an office building owned by Merrill Lynch, and we took over the first floor. And the mayor was trying to reach out to the White House to get air support and cover. And we were trying to figure out what our next step would be. The mayor was, not because I worked for him for so many years, it was amazing. Seemed like it was 3 or 4 steps before everybody else. He had handled hundreds of major incidents in New York City in his past 8 years as mayor. he had handled variations of what had happened on 9/11, the power outage, the building collapses, different issues, plane crashes, but he never handled anything as big as this, but he seemed like he was stealing pieces from all his past experiences, and he's moving along and trying to stay ahead of as what it seemed like every 2 minutes worsening situation.
Personally, I know you didn't have much time to think. You were straight into action straight away. How did you deal with it personally? How did you deal with what was going on and how you, what was going through your head personally as you were thinking? I know you were getting into work, but how did you deal with all that?
You know, it's one of those things. As the mayor drawed on his past experience, I had quite a exciting police career. I was involved in different incidences, shootings and such, and very active and worked with a bunch of great people. A lot of high-pressure situations, and was able to take that without knowing it, take that and remain calm and think where we should be, think where we should be going. My job was to make sure that I took care of the mayor, and that was what I had totally focused on. At one point, I received a call from our driver who was out in the car, and Richard had said there were bags and stuff left about the floor around the mayor's vehicle. And I says, well, Richie, people are dropping stuff. And he was having a tough time understanding what I was getting at. So I told Patty, I said, I'm going to go outside. I'm going to talk to Richie, make sure the cars are in the right spot in case we got to move. I went outside, and of course there were bags and shoes, but people that were leaving the area were dropping their belongings, and just women were taking off their high heels, and they were just heading north and east and west away from the location. And one of the strangest things in my life happened at that point. I started to hear a rumbling. Now, mind you, only a block and a half away from the towers. And I looked up, and I see this plume of dust coming and starting to roll towards us, and for the life of me, I couldn't figure out what was going on. I'm thinking it's a nuclear blast. I had no idea what it was. It wasn't registering. But one thing I did do is the vehicle, I was talking to Richie, put the car in reverse, and he got out of there, and I turned around as well, ran north, and then turned the block. And as I said to one of my friends, it was a little heavier. I said, my fat butt ran as fast as I could run. And as I turned the corner, there's a fire truck coming down the block. And I jump in front, and I'm dressed in a suit and tie, as we didn't wear uniforms in that detail. And I'm waving at the fire department to stop. Guys on the truck are looking at me like, what's wrong with this idiot? And then all of a sudden, that plume comes around the corner, and you can see their eyes like they didn't know what it was either. And it was an amazing day. And dealing with it at the end and through the days that followed, the hardest part was going to wakes and funerals. And I have in my office a picture of all the firefighters that are lost on 9/11. And I knew a few of the police officers directly as well. And when you started to see the children going up and speaking of their parents, and it just hit you that this is much more than numbers and much more than X amount of firemen and firefighters and X amount of police officers were dead, and Port Authority and banker investments and people that work for Cantor Fitzgerald and people that worked in the market there. And it just, you started to understand that this is, unfortunately, people that were no longer going to be around, and their children had to grow up minus a parent. And I literally attended for about 3 months, two or three, either wakes or funerals, memorials, every day. And that just tugged on your heart. It was just an awful, awful feeling to see the pain in the families and to see that some of these families weren't actually even burying their loved ones. They would have a helmet or small parts that were found. And you just saw just the pain that was in their hearts, and it just came through when you heard the children speak. So that was, to me, one of the hardest things to see. And to this day, every Thanksgiving, I see a lot of the rescue first responders' children as they are grown up at the Macy's Day event. Tuesday's Children does a event and brings the families together and see them grown up, and which is nice to see them overcoming such pain and such a loss of a parent.
Has spirituality helped you through?
You know, I always remember one of the, proverb or saying, when a fella is having a tough time, and he finally meets God, and he's talking to God, and it's footprints in the sand, and he's basically complaining to God, as he looks back at his life, in the footsteps in the sand, the footprints that he sees in the sand, and there's two sets of footprints, and then during the man's toughest part of his life, there's only one footprint. And the man was complaining that you weren't with me during those hard times. Look, there's only one set of footprints there. And God just looks at him and says, there's one set of footprints because I was carrying you then. And I tell you, if you weren't religious after 9/11, you found a sense of religion, spiritual guidance. I come from a very strong Irish Catholic family. My mom and dad, enormously religious, and was educated by the Christian Brothers and the nuns, and it was a good, strong cornerstone to have to deal with such an incident and such a disaster and such a terrible attack on America.
How have you lived your life differently since then?
Well, you tend to step back during major occurrences in your life, and you may dress something one way or another. One of the things I actually do remember asking myself after 9/11, several months later, when the mayor had left office in January 2002, I asked myself, is this as good as it gets? It's a line from a movie. And you know what? It's a good way of a check and balance in your life. You know, is this where I want to be? Is this what I want to do in life? Am I happy? And that's one of the things I constantly ask myself. And you know what? I speak the truth a little faster now. I try to be a better person as far as being respectful to other people. So you don't know if they'll be there tomorrow, which I saw.
What's it like working with America's mayor?
He's an amazing man. Been with him for 18 years. Seeing how he was prior to 9/11, dealing with firefighters and city employees and police officers that were shot or killed or burned, and dealing with the families, and how tough he was to get the city back into shape and wouldn't let the city fall and pick it up from its bootstraps and bring it up to where it should be. But then see him go back to Gracie Mansion, where the mayor resides while in office, and making sandwiches for family members that are at a hospital waiting to find out the condition of how their loved one was doing. Going into his own personal clothes, because the hospital was closed, and getting them sweatshirts, and going back and praying with the family, and seeing that sensitive, soft side of him, but also seeing the firm side of him. But the greatest thing I've ever seen is, after 9/11 and thinking about it, was Rudy was able to be honest to the people. If he didn't know, he basically would say he didn't know, but he would find out, and he would prepare himself to give the best answer he could when he was asked, how many people do you expect to be killed in the towers? And he didn't have a number. He thought the number would be thousands and thousands and thousands, tens of thousands of people possibly killed. And he just said, more than we can bear, whether it was one or 10,000. He knew that this was just an awful event. And but then to see him rally all city agencies and work so well with Governor Pataki at the time to put this together and just deal with the federal level and the state level and him being a local level and being all in the same room and understanding it's about the people and understanding about getting the job done. And they should have taken that and made it a management course for any future incidents that would happen in the United States. As we saw in the incidents that after 9/11, the local government didn't work well with the state government. The state government was blaming the federal government. The federal government doesn't know what to bring in. It just turns into a disaster. But when you have true leaders, you can get through some of the worst times. And it was amazing.
You speak a great passion there.
Yeah.
Your boss.
Yeah. He's an amazing person.
So tell me, what do you think of Ground Zero 360?
I think it is something that is long overdue. I have also something I'm very passionate about. I've attended every memorial with the mayor on 9/11. Every year since 2001. Unfortunately, I see less and less people attending this. It is something that can never be forgotten in my eyes. America was attacked, lost so many innocent people. Such courageous work done by people of the cloth, firefighters, police officers, nurses, civilians, iron workers, construction workers, they came down, sifted through the rubble, looking for survivors. And the passion that we had to find somebody and to not alive, then to find somebody to give somebody closure. And then to be able to step back and see how the city and the nation and the world rallied behind us. And then years later, what would be thousands would show up on the first couple. And it dwindled down. And projects like 360, which Paul is doing, is very, very important to remember what was done. And the courage and the dedication that the workers and the people and the families lived through. Yeah, it's just amazing. It's a good project.
It's important to educate people, maybe younger ones now that's not too familiar with it, but to educate people to exactly what happened, what was it like to be first responders there, and to mostly to never forget.
Yeah, we owe that to the families. The families that sacrificed their sons, their daughters, their husbands, their wives. We owe that to them, first of all. We owe it to the people that lost their lives. We owe it to the civilian, the janitor in the building, the guy from 608, a carpenter, that was working on a project, just trying to get through a day. We owe it to anybody that was involved that day and the days after. You know, great people we lost. Father Judge, an amazing man. Gansey. Chief Gansey. God, I could go through a list of wonderful, wonderful people. And just, we owe them that.
Shane.
Hey, lovely.